Battle of Mohács. The Battle of Mohács was one of the most consequential battles in Central European history. It was fought on August 29, 1526 near Mohács, Kingdom of Hungary, between the forces of the Kingdom of Hungary, led by Louis II, and those of the Ottoman Empire, led by Suleiman the Magnificent. The Ottoman victory led to the partition of Hungary for several centuries between the Ottoman Empire, the Habsburg Monarchy, and the Principality of Transylvania. Further, the death of Louis II as he fled the battle marked the end of the Jagiellonian dynasty in Hungary and Bohemia, whose dynastic claims passed to the House of Habsburg. The Battle of Mohács marked the end of the Middle Ages in Hungary. After the death of the absolutist King Matthias Corvinus in 1490, the Hungarian magnates, who did not want another heavy-handed king, procured the accession of Vladislaus II, King of Bohemia, because of his notorious weakness. He was known as King Dobra, or Dobritz in Hungarian orthography, for his habit of accepting, without question, every petition and document laid before him. The freshly elected King Vladislaus II donated most of the royal estates, regales and royalties to the nobility. By this method, the king tried to stabilize his new reign and preserve his popularity amongst the magnates. After the naive fiscal and land policy of the royal court, the central power began to experience severe financial difficulties, largely due to the enlargement of feudal lands at his expense. The noble estate of the parliament succeeded in reducing their tax burden by 70-80%, at the expense of the country's ability to defend itself. Vladislaus became the magnate's helpless prisoner. He could make no decision without their consent. The standing mercenary army of Matthias Corvinus was dissolved by the aristocracy. The magnates also dismantled the national administration systems and bureaucracy throughout the country. The country's defenses sagged as border guards and castle garrisons went unpaid, fortresses fell into disrepair, and initiatives to increase taxes to reinforce defenses were stifled. Hungary's international role declined, its political stability shaken, and social progress was deadlocked. The early appearance of Protestantism further worsened internal relations in the country. The strongest nobles were so busy oppressing the peasants and quarreling with the gentry class in the parliament that they failed to heed the agonized calls of King Louis II against the Turks. In 1514, the weakened and old King Vladislaus II faced a major peasant rebellion led by George Dozsa, which was ruthlessly crushed by the nobles, led by John Zapolya. After the Dozsa rebellion, the brutal suppression of the peasants greatly aided the 1526 Turkish invasion, as the Hungarians were no longer a politically united people. The resulting degradation of order paved the way for Ottoman preeminence. King Louis II of Hungary married Mary of Habsburg in 1522. The Ottomans saw that alliance as a threat to their power in the Balkans and worked to break it. After Suleiman I came to power, the High Court made the Hungarians at least one and possibly two offers of peace. It is unclear why Louis refused. It is possible that King Louis was well aware of Hungary's situation and he believed that war was a better option than peace. Even in peacetime, the Ottomans raided Hungarian lands and conquered small territories, but a final battle still offered a glimmer of hope. To such ends, in June 1526, an Ottoman expedition advanced up the Danube. King Francis I of France was defeated at the Battle of Pavia on February 24, 1525 by the troops of the Habsburg Holy Roman Emperor, Charles V. After several months in prison, Francis I was forced to sign the Treaty of Madrid. In a watershed moment in European diplomacy, Francis formed a formal Franco-Ottoman alliance with Sultan Suleiman the Magnificent as an ally against Charles. The French-Ottoman strategic, and sometimes tactical, alliance lasted for about 3 centuries. To relieve the Habsburg pressure on France, Francis asked Suleiman to make war on the Holy Roman Empire, and the road from Turkey to the Holy Roman Empire led across Hungary. The request of the French king coincided nicely with the ambitions of Suleiman in Europe and gave him an incentive to attack Hungary in 1526, leading to the Battle of Mohács. The Hungarians had long opposed Ottoman expansion in southeastern Europe. But in 1521 the Turks advanced up the Danube River and took Nendorfhöver, the strongest Hungarian fortress on the Danube, and Szabex. This left most of southern Hungary indefensible. The loss of Nendorfhöver caused great alarm in Hungary, but the huge 60,000-strong royal army, led by the king, but recruited too late and too slowly, neglected to take food along. Therefore, the army disbanded spontaneously under pressure from hunger and disease without even trying to recapture Belgrade from newly installed Turkish garrisons. In 1523, Archbishop Paul Tomori, a valiant priest soldier, was made captain of southern Hungary. The general apathy that had characterized the country forced him to lean on his own bishopric revenues when he started to repair and reinforce the second line of Hungary's border defense system. Peter Vered fell to the Turks on July 15, 1526 due to the chronic lack of castle garrisons. For about 400 kilometers along the Danube between Peter Vered and Buda, there was no single Hungarian town, village, or fortification of any sort. 3 years later, an Ottoman army set out from Istanbul on April 16, 1526, led by Suleiman the Magnificent personally. The Hungarian nobles, who still did not realize the magnitude of the approaching danger, did not immediately heed their king's call for troops. Eventually, the Hungarians assembled in three main units: the Transylvanian army under John Zápolya, charged with guarding the passes in the Transylvanian Alps, with between 8,000 and 13,000 men; the main army, led by Louis himself, and another smaller force, commanded by the Croatian Count Christoph Frankopan, numbering around 5,000 men. The Ottomans deployed the largest field artillery of Thera, comprising some 300 cannons, while the Hungarians had only 85 cannons, though even this number was greater than other contemporary Western European armies deployed in the battlefields. The geography of the area meant that the Hungarians could not know the Ottomans' ultimate goal until the latter crossed the Balkan Mountains, and when they did, the Transylvanian and Croatian forces were farther from Buda than the Ottomans were. Contemporary historical records, though sparse, indicate that Louis preferred a plan of retreat, in effect ceding the country to Ottoman advances, rather than directly engaging the Ottoman army in open battle. The Hungarian War Council, without waiting for reinforcements from Croatia and Transylvania only a few days' march away, made a serious tactical error by choosing the battlefield near Mohács, an open but uneven plain with some swampy marshes. The Ottomans had advanced toward Mohács almost unopposed. While Louis waited in Buda, they had besieged several towns, and crossed the Sava and Drava rivers. At Mohács, the Hungarians numbered some 25,000 to 30,000 soldiers. The only external help was a small contingent of Polish troops led by the royal captain Lenart Nowinski. The Ottoman army numbered perhaps 50,000, though some contemporary and modern-day historians put the number of the Ottoman troops at 100,000. Most of the Ottoman Balkan forces registered before this battle were described as Bosnians or Croats. The Hungarian army was arrayed to take advantage of the terrain and hoped to engage the Ottoman army piecemeal. They had the advantage that their troops were well rested, while the Turks had just completed a strenuous march in scorching summer heat. But rather than attacking the fatigued enemy immediately, the Hungarians let them struggle through the marshy terrain. It would have been unchivalrous to attack the enemy when they were not yet ready for battle. Hungary built up an expensive but obsolete army, structured similarly to that of King Francis I at the Battle of Pavia and mostly reliant on old-fashioned heavily armored knights on armored horses. The Hungarian battlefront consisted of two lines. The first had a center of mercenary infantry and artillery and the majority of the cavalry on either flank. The second was a mix of levy infantry and cavalry. The Ottoman army was a more modern force built around artillery and the elite, musket-armed janissaries. The remainder consisted of feudal Temarli cavalry and conscripted levies from Rumelia and the Balkans. As the first of Suleiman's troops, the Rumelian army, advanced onto the battlefield, they were attacked and routed by Hungarian troops led by Paul Tomori. This attack by the Hungarian right caused considerable chaos among the irregular Ottoman troops, but even as the Hungarian attack pressed forward, the Ottomans rallied with the arrival of Ottoman regulars deployed from the reserves. While the Hungarian right advanced far enough at one time to place Suleiman in danger from Hungarian bullets that struck his cuirass, the superiority of the Ottoman regulars and the timely charge of the janissaries, the elite troops of the Ottomans, probably overwhelmed the attackers, particularly on the Hungarian left. The Hungarians took serious casualties from these skillfully handled Turkish artillery and musket volleys. The Hungarians could not hold their positions, and those who did not flee were surrounded and killed or captured. The result was a disaster, with the Hungarians advancing into withering fire and flank attacks, and falling into the same trap that John Hunyadi had so often used successfully against the Ottomans. The king left the battlefield sometime around twilight but was thrown from his horse in a river at Chaly and died, weighed down by his heavy armor. Some 1,000 other Hungarian nobles and leaders were also killed. It is generally accepted that more than 14,000 Hungarian soldiers were killed in the initial battle. Suleiman could not believe that this small, suicidal army was all that the once powerful country could muster against him, so he waited at Mohács for a few days before moving cautiously against Buda. The victory did not give the Ottomans the security they wanted. Buda was left undefended, only the French and Venetian ambassadors waited for the Sultan to congratulate him on his great victory. Though they entered the unguarded evacuated Buda and pillaged the castle and surroundings, they retreated soon afterwards. It was not until 1541 that the Ottomans finally captured and occupied Buda following the 1541 siege of Buda. However, for all intents and purposes, the Battle of Mohács meant the end of the independent Kingdom of Hungary as a unified entity. Amid political chaos, the divided Hungarian nobility elected two kings simultaneously, John Zápolya in 1526 and Ferdinand of Austria in 1527. The Ottoman occupation was contested by the Habsburg Archduke of Austria, Ferdinand I, Louis's brother-in-law and successor by treaty with King Vladislaus II. Bohemia fell to the Habsburgs, who also dominated the northern and western parts of Hungary and the remnants of the Kingdom of Croatia, while the Ottomans held central Hungary and suzerainty over semi-independent Transylvania. This provided the Hungarians with sufficient impetus to continue to resist the Ottoman occupation, which they did for another 70 years. The Austrian branch of Habsburg monarchs needed the economic power of Hungary for the Ottoman Wars. During the Ottoman Wars, the territory of the former Kingdom of Hungary shrunk by around 70%. Despite these territorial and demographic losses, the smaller, heavily war-torn Royal Hungary had remained economically more important than Austria or the Kingdom of Bohemia even at the end of the 16th century. Of Ferdinand's territories, the depleted Kingdom of Hungary was at that time his largest source of revenue. The subsequent near-constant warfare required a sustained commitment of Ottoman forces, proving a drain on resources that the largely rural and war-torn kingdom proved unable to repay. Christian armies besieged Buda several times during the 16th century, and Suleiman himself died of natural causes in Hungary during the Battle of Szigetvár in 1566. There were also two unsuccessful Ottoman sieges of Eger, which did not fall until 1596, 70 years after the Ottoman victory at Mohács. The Turks proved unable to conquer the northern and western parts of Hungary, which belonged to the Habsburg monarchs. A book on the Turkish culture was written by Georgius Bartholomaeus with information obtained from Christian troops released by the Ottomans after the battle. Mohács is seen by many Hungarians as the decisive downward turning point in the country's history, a national trauma that persists in the nation's folk memory. For moments of bad luck, Hungarians still say, more was lost at Mohács. Hungarians view Mohács as marking the end of an independent and powerful European nation. Whilst Mohács was a decisive loss, it was the aftermath that truly put an end to independent Hungary. The ensuing 200 years of near-constant warfare between the two empires, Habsburg and Ottoman, turned Hungary into a perpetual battlefield. The countryside was regularly ravaged by armies moving back and forth, in turn devastating the population. Only in the 19th century would Hungary regain some degree of autonomy, with full independence coming only after the First World War. However, the Treaty of Trianon awarded much of its former land to other states, and Hungary has never regained its former political power. In the 464 years from 1525 to 1989, Hungary spent the vast majority of the time under the direct or indirect domination of a foreign power. These foreign powers were, successively, the Ottoman Empire, the Holy Roman Empire, the Austrian Empire, and the Soviet Union. Furthermore, between 1867 and 1918, Hungary was widely considered the junior partner in the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Autonomy was granted, but stopped well short of independence. The battlefield, beside the village of Szatmárdi, became an official National Historical Memorial Site in 1976 on the 450th anniversary of the battle. The memorial was designed by architect György Vadas. A new reception hall and exhibition building, also designed by Vadas and partially funded by the European Union, was completed in 2011. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.